Okay.
Getting dressed is
I
interesting.
just check if we are live. I think we are. I will just check. Doesn't show immediately. Yeah, yes, we are live. Okay. Hello, everyone. This is me, Meeta Dani. You must be knowing me already, so I'm not introducing myself again. And with me today, we have Laurie Goldsetin-Warren. And I cannot say a lot about her. She's having 15 to 16 tags behind her name. Few of them are WHS and TWSA. She's a senior-most member of many of the organizations, and her paintings are totally out of the world. If you go and check her website, you will see that the way she paints is quite different and very, very impressive. The way she uses watercolor is absolutely fabulous. I cannot tell you enough about her. I would like her to introduce herself, and I'm feeling so grateful to her that when I requested Laurie to come for the interview, she simply said, "Of course, yes." She said like that, and today she is here. So please, you can ask questions, put up your questions now from now onwards so that I get enough time to accommodate your question here. I do have lots of questions for you, Laurie. So I would like you to say something about yourself, how you started your art journey and all that.
Okay, well, hello everyone. Hello, Mita. Thanks for having me. I've been painting watercolors for just a little over 20 years since I moved here to
Wow.
West Virginia from New York. I used to live in New York. And when I moved down here, we live way out in the country. So I thought I'd better do something to keep myself out of trouble. And I've always been interested in art. So I joined a small little art guild here in West Virginia and learned from the artists in that group, and most of them were watercolorists, so that's how I got drawn to watercolor. And from there, I started taking workshops and getting an education. I did not go to college for art. The only school I took after high school was beauty school, so I was a beautician, hairstylist, and I learned a lot about color. So that's actually a great way to learn all about color and color mixing. But anyway, so that once I moved here, I started painting watercolors. I just fell in love with the medium. And then it went on from there. And I started entering little local shows and moved into national shows and international shows. And I've been very blessed so far.
So you said that you are a hairstylist, and I think I have read about you that you also participated in some contest which expected you to have hairstyles totally different than what we see every normal day. So did that also
Oh yeah.
help your paintings?
It does. Well, it's cre I've always loved creative anything. And the hair sh they're just called hair expositions or hair shows. And they take place all over the country in the US and I'm sure other countries. But hair students that are in school still and also professionals join these competitions and they're fantasy hair competitions. So it's really nothing you would see on the street. Like my model, I actually weaved her hair into a clamshell with a pearl in the middle of it. So it's things like that. It's just avant-garde hair. And they do a little like runway fashion show with the models. You make an outfit for them and everything. And it's a lot of fun. It really is. I thoroughly enjoyed that for the years that I did the hairstyling. But when I moved down to West Virginia, I settled into something different, which turned out to be even better. I love it even more than I ever loved doing hair. I love painting.
This is giving me a very good idea that why not we have a watercolor contest or something in global association, which will actually demand artists to do watercolors in a very, very different style.
It would be interesting, yeah, to do
Isn't
something,
it?
yeah, avant-garde, either subject or technique. It would have to
Technique or
be something
subjects.
out of the box, yeah, it
Yeah,
would be
think
fun.
out of the box. I always encourage my students to think out of the box. So
I always think out of the box. This is great advice for anybody starting out. Let's say you've been painting for 4 or 5 years. You look back at some of your earlier work and you think, yeah, that painting was not successful. I didn't like that. Take that same idea, draw it again, assuming your composition is okay. You like that, but you just don't like the way it turned out, the technique. Pick a different technique. Instead of using a brush, mask and pour that painting. This is a poured painting behind me that I'm working on right now. This is all done by just pouring and masking. So there's no brush, or the mouth atomizer or an airbrush you can also use to do it with that technique. And you might find out that that painting that you don't like so much is a huge success with just a different technique. So never give up on an idea. You might have, you loved it enough to paint it once. Try it again with a different technique. And I've done that several times. And usually my second, even third attempt with different techniques end up being an award winner. So don't ever give up on something you love just because it didn't turn out the first time.
Thank you so much for giving such a valuable advice. I will surely try to see if I can paint something based on what I have already painted. And I would like, I have got a list of questions for you. In your art journey, you must have faced a lot of difficulties because, you know, that time there were no internet and all that. Can you please elaborately tell us about what are the difficulties that you faced?
Okay. When I started out, as Mita said, there was internet, but not a lot of internet watercolor competitions or things like that. Back when I started, we actually had to take a photograph with a real camera. Mm-hmm. We had a slide. We had to take the silver Mylar film and crop our slide so it's just the image showed. And then you had to put it in a padded envelope with your entry fee and form and send it in. That's how we used to enter these shows. Big hassle compared to today, big hassle. But so that was difficult. But also when I started, probably the first 4 or 5 years I was painting, I didn't even make it into local exhibitions. I was
5 years.
Rejected. I have books and I keep those books. I have little notebooks for each year that shows what I entered, what the competition was, the deadline, when the painting's coming back. It keeps me organized. But the first 4 or 5 years, rejected, the whole book. The whole book. So don't get that. That's what I'm going to, I mean, that is the biggest thing. And this is what I tell my students all the time. It's kind of my slogan, is that you cannot think to enter your work in any, and I don't care if you're a musician, if you're an artist, if you're an actor, actress, if you're in the arts and you want to succeed, you better have the mentality of a pit bull and not a poodle, because you will fail. I don't care how many times people tell you your work's not good enough, it's not good enough, it's not good enough. If you keep working on your craft and you keep that passion going and you're working every day, at least for an hour a day every day on your art, you will make it. I guarantee it, because I did it without an education, without a mentor, without any help except for these wonderful people at this little local art guild. They were the only ones that were helping me when I started. So you, if I can do it, you can do it. I was just a housewife raising preteens and going to my school. Yeah.
It is so much of resilience. You know, I also think that many people, they consider that, you know, few people are talented and lucky. They consider that few people, like some people, are God gifted, but they don't see the efforts that they are putting.
They're working. Yeah. That's the thing. A working artist is a successful artist. And I don't care if it's day two that you've touched watercolors. You've only been doing it for 2 days versus 20 years. If you're touching that paint every day, you are on the road to success. Plain and simple. That's it. And some of the best artists in the world who I was fortunate enough to study with when I began, one of them you all know, John Salmonen. Best piece of advice I ever got, two pieces of advice I got in his workshop when I took it, was never price your art too low when you're selling your art. Never do that, because people think, well, it only took me 3 hours to paint this, or it only took me a week to paint this, whatever it is. and they're thinking per hour, like they're turning out widgets at a factory. And it's like, no. What about that? What about 20 years that you've paid in your blood, sweat, and tears, and the money that you paid for education?
Right.
That all goes into that mix. That's not just, oh, it took me 3 hours to paint it, so, oh, I don't know, $100 an hour or $300, that's good. No. There's many, many, many more things that have gone into that. Right. That was a blank piece of paper that you turned into a work of art. Always keep that in your mind. Okay, so that was the other piece of advice. I got to give John's other piece of advice was to paint every day.
I'm not doing that.
I just had shoulder surgery, so, but I am still in my studio every day. I'm either writing things, I'm working on my website, I'm until I'm better to actually paint, I'm doing that. And I have been painting left-handed. That's why I'm pouring this painting behind me, because I just need one hand to pour the paint. I don't need a hand with a brush. So, it is really important to keep, and it's not like you're gonna forget, but your skill does drop. I mean, you skipping a day or two, probably not a huge deal, but when I know some artists that only paint 3 paintings a year, and it's not because they're that complex, they're just only doing 3 a year, 3 pretty simple paintings.
I am that one.
Yours are not simple. Yours are not simple. But then your talent is going to decline. You will have a few steps backwards. So, but if you keep that paint damp and keep your brushes wet every day, you will succeed. It's just, I can't say it enough how to guarantee that will happen.
I'm going to write it down for myself. This is an advice which I have to literally follow, because, you know, I'm not doing a lot of painting these days.
But you're doing a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff.
Do paint every day. This is for me. People, please, yes, who are listening to this interview or who is going to watch this interview, the recorded version, please take a note that, you know, when Laurie is saying something, it is like, you know, golden nuggets. Many people, they think that how I can achieve success, you know, they are so puzzled of, they are not understanding the simple facts which are coming from people like Laurie, from, you know, John Selmanen, who advised Laurie. So these are the simplest facts which will give you success, that, you know, work nonstop and paint every day. This is for me, especially. I need to do paint every day.
And as far, you were saying about talent and luck. Okay. Talent is not something that most of us are born with. When I was growing up, my older brother, Todd, was the family artist. He was like killing it, and he was just an excellent draftsman, excellent at drawing. And he liked to do a lot of cartoons and cartooning, but his stuff was like blowing teenagers away when he was little. I mean, that's how good he was. So he was the family artist, I wasn't. And so talent is inborn in some people to a degree, but it doesn't mean that because you weren't born with that, like I was not born as talented at drawing as my brother, it doesn't mean that you can't get that talent. The way to get it is with passion. If you have a passion for anything, if you literally feel like you can't breathe that day because you didn't do that activity, whether it be music or painting, that's passion. So if you have that passion, you will do it every day. If you do it every day, you will get better. Yeah. If you get better, you will succeed. It's just an easy roadmap. It's plain and simple. So passion is where it begins, not talent. It begins with passion. The talent will come with practice.
Do you feel that a lot of artists, not every artist, but a lot of artists nowadays, like the upcoming artist, their main problem is they don't focus on getting their painting better. They focus on participating in contest, winning the contest, or participating in exhibitions more as compared to focusing on learning. Do you believe that?
I think yes, and they're doing it backwards. That's backwards thinking. Because once you start painting for a competition, once you start painting for a juror, like if I was sending a painting in and John Selmanen was the juror, so I'm going to send it a New York City scape. No, first of all, I mean, I don't know about them, but I've juried many shows now also. I don't want to see work like mine. I see my work every day. in my studio. I don't want to see other people paint like me. I want to see their soul on paper. I want to see their message, their song. I don't want to see my song. I know my song. I want to see their song. So that's my best advice. If you're sending koi to Cheng Ki Chi, if you're sending cityscapes to John Salmanen, stop it. Just stop it. Paint your own message. And it'll touch a juror so much more than trying to send them their message. They know their message. They don't need to see it again.
Yeah.
So that's a big piece of advice too. Never paint for a juror, never paint for an exhibition. Paint what is here in your heart today, something that excites you, something that maybe even makes you sad, something that makes you laugh. Paint that. That'll touch a juror faster than anything else.
A confession here, planned. I believe in telling the facts. A very big mistake this year, 2019, started for me with a big mistake. So it is okay to share mistakes, you know? So what happened is I was too busy with Global Association of Watercolor Artists, and the date for submission of a painting was getting closer and closer and closer, and I was not able to paint. Mm-hmm. So I did fast. I think one day I painted for more than 18 hours nonstop. 18 hours. Like, I did not eat. I did not sleep the whole night I was painting in January. And when I saw that painting, I thought that this is not me. This painting is not Meeta Rani. So I felt so horribly bad. I did submitted it in a show, but I felt really, really bad. And I thought that, okay, I need to give myself a punishment for this year. So for this year, I did not participate in any of the contest, because, you know, that I should never forget what I did, a big mistake. If I have to participate in a contest, I should prepare beforehand and not at the end of the moment. So maybe other people, they don't think that it is a big mistake. It actually was. When your heart, your soul, your whole talent is not there in your painting, that painting will never make impression. And forget about what other people are thinking. What I think about my painting is the most thing which matters to me. And I felt that I did a lot of injustice to that painting. Maybe I was busy for a valid reason, but that doesn't mean I can just carry on with the painting, because, you know, the layers of watercolor, it takes time to dry. And if I'm painting nonstop on a piece of paper for 18 hours, I am getting tired. My painting paper is getting tired. So this is the biggest mistake. And another biggest mistake which people make is they console themselves for making a mistake, big mistake. I don't do that. If I do a mistake, then I take care that I do take a note. And for this mistake, it was good for me to give myself a punishment. A little crazy, right?
I'll tell you my biggest mistake this year, this past year. I was doing a workshop in Midland, Texas. And we were doing shiny metal, rusty metal. That was the workshop, two different projects. And I had my drawing all prepared and I was ready to start masking, and they were all out there. They had their drawings prepared and we're all ready to start masking. I go to take a sip of coffee and they had these styrofoam cups, and I hit the edge of my board or my paper, and it just knocked it enough where coffee went all over me, all over my painting. Or my, you know, my paper with my drawing. I mean, brown everywhere. So they're over out there masking, and they're all studiously doing their thing. I'm like getting towels and mopping up my paper, mopping up my clothes. But my punishment was I had to paint on that and come out with a successful painting for my workshop people. So I punished myself too, but it did come out okay. I just went darker with my colors, so those stained areas looked white, because I was going darker with all my colors, and it actually came out.
I think you shared it on your Facebook. I think you also
did
shared that. Yeah.
On Facebook, yeah, it was a mess, and they just loved it though. I've painted with that group before. They're a really talented, fun bunch of artists in Midland, but yeah, it was a mess.
So whoever are listening to this interview, please note that even Laurie makes mistake, even Meeta Dani makes mistake. Making mistake is good, but you know, you need to take a note of what mistake you are making and why you are making a mistake, and you have to tell yourself that you should never make those type of mistakes again, because repeating mistakes is like telling yourself that it is okay to make mistakes, right? So I've got another question for you. Would you like to share any interesting episode of your artistic career? Any good episode or bad episode or horrible episode, anything?
Okay, let me think. Well, I'll share a good and a bad. How's that? The good first. This is also for people starting out that want to enter, you know, competitions that aren't super expensive, but get you out there and get you recognized by not only your peers, but you know, but also people in the art communities, you know, like gallery owners, things like that. Is probably mine. Biggest success initially was I did get third place in the Water Media competition. That's Watercolor Artist Magazine. So there was a, you know, like little write up and a big picture of my painting. And it's important to keep an eye on things like that, those kind of competitions, especially magazine ones or book ones. A lot of people will see your work and they'll start associating you and your style with your name. And that's one way to build up your reputation. So that was one of the happiest early successes in my career, was that. And it did help my career quite a bit. I noticed I started getting into shows more. I definitely had more confidence in that style of that painting, which has now become my style. Now the bad was I had a painting that won Best of Show at the International at Northwest Watercolor Society. And painting came back from the exhibition. Then I sent it out to, I think it was Louisiana Watercolor Society, to another international, it got in. But on the way back, UPS annihilated the painting. I mean, the frame, the paper, they just murdered it. I think they drove a forklift into it. The box, the painting, everything was just smashed and crushed, which is sad, but it was also a painting of my daughter-in-law. And it was one of the ones she really wanted someday when I pass away or whatever. And it was going to go to her. So she was really sad. So I had to repaint that for her. But that hurt. It was a very successful painting. I did okay redoing it, but it's never exactly the same. Mm-hmm. But at least there's one for her now. But that was crushing. And it happens to all of us who ship our paintings eventually. One gets lost or gets damaged or whatever. So if you're going to send your work out, be prepared. It's going to happen to you someday, but keep in mind, it's something that you maybe can redo again or something similar to it. You know, it's not the end of the world, but it made me sad for about a week or two until I painted it again. So
I really liked that story. Like, you know, you said that it showed your resilience. It is such a good quality. Like, you know, you are getting rejected again and again for 4 or 5 years and you kept going. So that is so good. Do you think nowadays, what is the major issues with upcoming artists? Can you give some light on that? Like, you have judged so many people and you have talked to so many people. What is the major issues with upcoming artists nowadays?
Okay. I would never tell anyone like when they should start or entering competitions or things. I mean, that's totally your vision. If you see your work improving and you think you're ready compared to what you've seen in the magazines and in the catalogs from exhibitions, then by all means enter. The big thing, and this is what I've seen a lot of, and this is everywhere, learn to photograph your work correctly. If you're not getting into shows, and this was probably part of my problem, why I wasn't getting in for 4 or 5 years. I was not photographing my work well. Of course, we were working with slides and Mylar film. It wasn't digital like today, so there was no editing. You just, whatever was on your slide is what you were stuck with. But a lot of them I notice are dark And I know that they're more colorful in person. I know they probably look brighter in person, but I can't, as a juror, I'm not allowed to guess that and let your work in.
Right.
So make sure you're photographing correctly. You really should have the painting right next to your computer when you're editing your painting, you know, your image, and make sure they look the same, you know, and that's a big thing I see. The other thing is, I think not all young artists, but a lot of younger artists, and by younger, I mean, I'm 56, so, you know, 30s, 40s even, are younger. They're not investing in their art career like I did. I don't know about everybody in my generation either, but I, like I said, could not go to college. My parents had five kids. They could not afford to send us all to college. So I, when I moved here and met these people at this art guild, they started telling me about this place where you could go take workshops, Cheap Joe's in North Carolina. So I started going there every year, just once a year, and studying for a week with people like John Selmanen and Ron Ranson. I mean, I had some wonderful instructors there, but it costs a lot of money. It's, you know, you got to pay for hotel, you got to pay for the workshop, your food while you're there, your travel expenses. And I see today that these younger artists are not doing that. They're all trying to learn on YouTube. And the problem with everybody learning on the same YouTube clips is that a lot of the work is starting to look kind of the same, like it's all homogenized and very similar looking. Because yeah, I can almost spot somebody who studied only on YouTube. Not all the time. If they're working beyond YouTube on their own, then I can't tell. But if I see someone who's strictly just studying on YouTube, I can kind of tell because their work looks very similar to a lot of other people in the same competition.
I'm rising my collar. I learned from YouTube.
I think you went beyond a little bit what you were just learning on YouTube, though. I mean, even if you're going to do that, at least go to one workshop a year. I would tell you to at least do that. You know, whoever your favorite artist is, if they're coming anywhere near where you live, especially if they're coming within driving distance where you don't have to pay for hotel, you should have your butt in a chair and go to that workshop.
Okay, I want to share something, Laurie. I wanted to go to Ona Kingdon's workshop, but you know, she lives in Toronto and I live in Burnaby and quite a lot of distance and with a lot of responsibilities, like, you know, my kids are still small. I think when they will grow up, that time also I will say the same thing. But anyways, I cannot leave my kids and go for workshop. And that's why you haven't seen me going here and there. I work from my home. But I really wanted to go and participate in Ona Kingdon's workshop. So what I am doing is I'm organizing a workshop in Vancouver and Ona Kingdon is flying here. She's flying here and I told her that I'm organizing this workshop only because I want to participate in that workshop. And I want to learn her styles, her technique, and you know, the softness that she's having in her paintings. Yes. I want to learn that. And for doing that, I'm taking a lot of burden. Like, you know, I'm organizing means I'm finding out the venue, then I'm doing the bookings, I am doing the registrations, all those things. Mm-hmm. So it is, you know, to all the viewers, I'm talking to you that if the well is not, if you cannot go to the well, you try to bring the well in front of you, but do whatever it takes to make sure that you are learning. You know, I will give you another example to prove your point that when I started my very first online course, Understanding Watercolor Fundamentals, and I gave it for free, 400 people they joined, 400. Mm. Now I'm giving it for a very, very nominal amount. That is a 1 month course and hardly few people are participating. It is not because they don't know that I'm talented or they don't know the results which I'm having with my students, but just because, you know, they are not so much encouraged to spend even a little amount to get that valuable knowledge. YouTube videos which you said, they will give you the pure technical knowledge. But when you are studying from Laurie, when you are studying from Meeta, you are studying from Ona, in between those pure technical knowledge, we talk a lot. We convey a lot of information. Okay. Mm-hmm. And that talk also matters. This talk you will never get in the YouTube videos, isn't it?
And you learn, this is very important, which a lot of people don't think of. And I don't, young people who have never been to a workshop wouldn't even know this. You learn from the other people in the workshop. I get tips from people who take my workshop. Just might be a brush they're using, or just the way that they're applying paint, something different than what I do. You learn from everyone in that room. It becomes a little community for 3 days or 5 days. And you all become friends and learn from each other. It's a very minor, very relaxed, non-competitive, a lot of laughter, but a lot of techniques. That's what my workshops are. And we all learn from each other. I mean, I've made a lot of great friends all over the country from these workshops, and we all keep in touch on Facebook. And I've been back to some places several times. But again, and that's what I tell some people online, they'll say workshops coming up in whatever, in Cloudcroft, New Mexico. And they'll be like, oh, I wish it was closer. And I said, well, if you have an art group near you, give them my name. I'll be happy to send information. You know, I don't care. I'll paint anywhere. You know, so most of us artists will go anywhere. So just invite us and we'll be at your door, and you don't have to pay for hotel and all that. So, but it's worth it. There's a whole different, and I'm actually thinking of possibly doing an article on this, because it's something I really strongly believe in. I think if the actual interpersonal live workshops totally die out, we're going to really be missing something in the art community. Because I have met some wonderful artists as teachers and as my students, John Salmonen, I've met Ron Ranson before he passed away, was a great mentor. You're missing out if you don't actually meet these people face to face. Watching a video of them, here's how I paint, which in 30 minutes or an hour, even video, you're not going to see everything they do. You're going to see a little snippet of what they do. But to sit there and watch them paint for a week or for 3 days, you will get, not to mention getting to talk to them, interact with them, ask them questions, get real-time answers as you're working. There's nothing like it. So I encourage everyone, if you really truly like someone and you want to study with them, if you have, and it doesn't have to be a big organization like, you know, AWS or NWS, even if you have a little art guild, our little guild here, Seneca Trail, we've had wonderful artists come here. You know, Bill Varsick, I mean, people that are nationally known, internationally known, we've had come here to our little tiny country art guild. So all you gotta do is invite people, they'll come. So, you know, you can still study with them. So okay. It's possible.
I was having a question. This is a little bit tricky here. It cannot have a single answer, but then I want that answer from you. When I was just started learning watercolors and started painting watercolors, I was going through a very bad phase in my life, and watercolor pulled me out from that bad phase, and it gave me a lot of strength to carry forward. But this does not happen with everyone, right? Like this bad phase and all those things. So they focus a lot on, they get discouraged, easily discouraged with failures. Mm-hmm. Right. Can you please tell everyone how failure is super crucial for achieving success? Can you give some light? Because it is so important. I cannot tell enough about the importance of failure.
Oh, yeah. To go back to my foil painting that I spilled coffee all over. Now I'm sitting here in front of a room of, I forget how many artists were in the class, but there was a bunch of them all staring at me, waiting to watch me how I was going to turn this brown stained piece of paper into a pretty painting. And in that instant, I mean, it comes from experience. I just did everything way darker to make those stained brown areas look white or whiter than they would if I went with my original palette of what I was thinking before I started the class. So it's, failure is always an educator. You have to look at it that way. It's an opportunity to correct, to figure out how to correct. If you don't make the mistake, there's no need to figure anything out. If you're just painting perfect all the time, I don't know who does that, but I'm sure somebody thinks they do. But if you're painting perfect all the time, you're missing out on that chance to learn something new. my whole education is based on mistakes. Here's a funny story. I took a workshop at Cheap Joe's with Tom Jones. He's a Florida artist, wonderful artist. And he told us it was like a rainy kind of yucky day. And there's these windows that go around the whole room pretty much at Cheap Joe's. And he said, just pick out something and paint it. And he gave us like so much time, a few minutes to get something on paper. No drawing, just paint it and get it. Well, he brought him up to the front of the room so everybody could see our work one by one. This is like, I think he was my very first workshop. They brought my painting up and I did these trees that were outside the window. And he goes, he looks at my painting and he said, okay, he doesn't know it's mine. And he goes, okay, who in this room sees palm trees outside? Because they were pine trees, not palm trees. But my pine trees looked like palm trees. And the whole room is laughing. I'm laughing. He's laughing. But again, it was, I was new. I was not drawing. I just had to do it quick with a wet brush, which I never did. And, you know, but I learned from that. I was like, okay, just because I was given so much time to paint this quick thing doesn't mean I couldn't have slowed down and done a better job instead of just making this big scroll of trees. So mistakes, they're also can be fun. I mean, they can be challenges. They can be fun. It's a funny story to tell later, like the palm trees. You know,
mistakes,
but
can be fun, right? I will write it in my book. I will write it in my book. I'm just writing. Mistakes can be fun.
They can be. I mean, some of my best stories are about mistakes I made, not about successes or, you know, I mean, you win a big award, a big show, that's exciting until you cash the check and you put the ribbon away and you move on to the next day and then it's kind of forgotten. But the mistakes you make, the friendships you make in workshops, the even the friendships I make on Facebook, those are the things that bring a smile to my face every day. It's not the big awards. It's usually the little mistakes or the funny stories or, you know, those things. I mean, Midland, they were teasing me about that coffee all week long. We had fun with that for 5 days because I spilled my coffee.
And it can be a little embarrassing, like, you know, you are the tutor and you are making this mistake. But on the other hand, if you see that the tutor is making mistakes, so the students will feel, okay, she's making mistake and she's okay with it. So they are also learning the same.
Yeah. In other words, if you spill a cup of coffee all over your drawing, paint away. Don't throw it away. Let it dry and start painting. See what happens. It might be wonderful.
Yeah. So it is your mindset, you know, the mindset of the upcoming artist or the beginner artist, they will feel, oh God, what I did, it is horrible, I should throw it up. Okay. And mindset of the advanced artist like Laurie, she will not throw it up. She will instead figure it out what to do next. Isn't it? That is a very big mindset thing.
Yeah. I mean, there is no failure. There's just a chance to learn something. That's how you got to look at it. When you see a mistake and you know, oh, I shouldn't have put that red on there or something, then now stop. Don't worry that it's drying. Just think about it for a minute and go, okay, now how do I neutralize that red so it's not so bright? You wait for it to dry, a nice glaze of green knocks it back and all of a sudden everything's okay again and you just learned something. So yeah, just don't panic. And that's what I find a lot of students, and oh, this is one thing in workshops, which I do harp on with my students. I don't even like people having tissue right here because there's so many of them. They make a mistake and smoosh, 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 and they're trying to dab it up so quick and they're just making a brown mess. And it's like, don't do that. Let it dry, then figure out how to change it. Don't mush, mush, mush all the time with the tissue. That's not a great way to fix mistakes. Usually you're making a worse mistake. So let your mistake dry, then calmly, sanely figure it out instead of panicking.
This also depends upon the style of painting, isn't it? Like you are pouring it, so you can wait for it to dry and then figure it out. But when we are doing a realistic painting and if we are making a mistake, the first thing is that you can dab a tissue paper and just blot it up.
Here's another trick I teach people. I'll put it up here so you can see. All right, so here's, I don't know if I can hold this high enough. Say this is your paper. Mm-hmm. Don't go doing this necessarily, this mush mush with the big ball. You're much better off tearing the tissue. And I like cheap, like this is dollar store tissue. That's my favorite. But if you tear it, see all those little fibers, mm-hmm. all these little rough edges? If you just set them into a puddle of paint, this will actually sit up like this, like a little tent. It'll soak up a lot of that pigment and water without you mushing all the edges and things. Okay. And you just set up a few of these along the path. And that I just don't like this. Whenever I see this, they're usually pushing it into areas. They're making a bigger mess is what I'm saying. Mm. They're pushing it into other areas because they're not even moving it. They're just the same thing. Mush, 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 mush. So they're making a stamp of that color everywhere. So it's okay to use tissue, but I don't like people using it as like a stamp too hard because you're just making a big mess. And even in realism, like let's say I'm looking at your painting behind you on your daughter's arm. If an area was too warm or too red, even then, while it's, if it's still all uniformly damp or wet, you could drop a tiny glaze of green in there and let it just mush in with the red and it would right. knock it back a little. Or if you wait for it to dry, put a little green in, then just soften the edge with a wet brush. And you could still correct it, dry or wet. So there's, as long as you think it through, you can, that's one thing I know is you can fix anything. People yeah. panic how watercolor is so unforgiving. You can fix anything. If I can fix a whole cup of coffee, you can fix anything.
I will give a bigger example here. Yours was only coffee. I will give a bigger example, you know, because Uh-oh. People need to know what other people make mistakes. So I was traveling from here to three, four cities after from Burnaby. And it was like almost two and a half hours journey from here to the place where I was giving a work demonstration. And I was carrying a lot of stuff, my paintings, my books, my workshop things, and a lot of other things. Like usually I carry a lot of books and paintings and all that just to show other people while giving demonstration. And my whole luggage was so packed that it did not had any place to carry my brushes and my palette. A plastic, big plastic palette and my brushes. And I was carrying it in another carry bag. So I was holding something in this hand. I was holding a big backpack. And then I was carrying a packet with a lot of brushes and the palette. So I traveled from here to the bus, to the train station, like subway station in bus. And then from that bus, I went to another station by subway. And from there to another place by bus. And then from there again to the spot in the bus, through bus. So when I was just 10 minutes to reach the spot, I realized that I am not carrying that brush and the palette.
Oh no.
So it was a huge mistake. And I was thinking, oh my God, what I'm going to do? I'm supposed to make this particular thing in the workshop. What I'm going to do? I cannot go back because it is almost 2 hours journey. Then there is no shop. I just Googled out. There was no shop nearby which was having brush. But there were so many or more than 50 people waiting for me for the demonstration in that place. So I thought I have to show up. I was so horribly mad at myself, but I planned that I at least will show up. But the good thing was I always take care to reach the spot at least 1 hour before. So I was there at least 1 hour before. And I asked all the people, like whoever was there, that if they are having any brush or palette. So none of them had watercolor brushes, but out of one person, he was quite old, and he said that I am an oil paint artist. So I have oil paint brushes. And he said that I live nearby, so I can go and come back within this time. Mm-hmm. And he said that I don't have a palette, and nobody had that palette. So, you know, the food tray, the empty food tray, which has got a lot of sections, I use that as palette. You know, that was plastic one. Luckily, that was plastic one. That was not paper one. So luckily, that was plastic one. And that was a used one. So I went to the kitchen and I washed that. And that I used as a palette. And I painted with oil paint brushes. You know, the oil paint brushes are totally different. And because they're used to oils, they will not even pick up watercolor. So I completely changed my plan. I said that, okay, 1 hour I have to give valuable knowledge. The knowledge that they will not have otherwise, the knowledge that after going home they can implement, and the knowledge that they will feel happy about it, even I cannot make a brilliant painting, even if like that. So I did a painting with those oil paint brushes.
You know, there was the first lesson.
Yeah, but the thing is, they were so happy that all my books got sold.
Wow.
And the first thing I did is I declared that. I declared that this is a mistake. This is the situation. And I will have to change my plans. The way I was thinking about this demonstration will be different, because now I have oil paint brushes. So I will give you a painting. I will give you knowledge, but I will not be using my super fine 000 brush.
Right. So, yeah.
So that is a big, huge mistake. That is a big, huge mistake. But you know, when we come across this mistake and when we overcome that mistake, we do get a lot of confidence that next time if this happens, it will not happen, because I am more careful nowadays. But if it happens, I will have the courage that, okay, I have faced horrible situations. This situation is much better than those horrible situations.
Right. I can do it. Yeah.
Yeah, I can do it.
Those 1 hour demos are intimidating, to say the least. When I went, I had to do one in Chicago earlier this year in April. And I was going to show them how to do an atomized background, where you use the mouth atomizer and you blow the background. And so I just brought one of my jars, which are like these, just like these little cover jars. Now I put tape around where it connects, like a couple layers of tape. Then I put it in a Ziploc bag and I put it in my carry-on, okay? And so it wasn't, you know, pressurized in the back of the plane or whatever. But I get there, I go to take out my stuff for this demo, that black paint was everywhere. It was on my demo piece. It was on, I mean, it was just everywhere, and it was black.
Oh, God.
And I'm like, are you kidding me? I'm like, a Ziploc bag and tape, and I'm going, it's still, and I had it screwed on tight and it still leaked. But yeah, it was kind of like your thing. It was like a momentary panic, but luckily I had not gotten on the subject of my painting. It was just a little bit on the background and spots, and I was going to atomize over that anyway. So I was like, no big deal. But I, that initial panic, I know what you're saying. It's like, oh no, what am I going to do? So it's fun. I mean, those are challenging. I've done a cityscape in an hour, a New York cityscape night scene. I've done a 3-piece of glass still life in an hour. I've done portraits in an hour. And to show everyone what I do for the entire painting is I do mine in stages. I don't know if you probably have to do that too, because your stuff is very detailed. So I do my paintings in stages. So that way, here's step one, I do it, throw it aside and flip over the next one. Here's step one dry. So then I can do step two.
This I learned from Lana. This I learned when I was new, very, very new, and I was going for my very first workshop demonstration, and the demonstration was supposed to happen in 1 hour. I asked Lana, how can I paint something in 1 hour? And you know, you just don't have to focus on painting. You have to talk, you have to interact with people. You have to welcome the people. So time flies by, and 1 hour is so less for a realistic type of painting. She said that you take stages of painting, stage number one, stage number two. You have to show them how to reach from stage 0 to 1 and 1 to 2 and 2 to 3. You don't have to show the entire painting. So that solved my problem. So to all
I'm more impressionistic. So I can do like, my work is not as realistic. It's more impressionistic. So within 5 or 6 steps, I can do a completed cityscape, and they literally see every single thing I do. So they know exactly in an hour how I do a cityscape. It's just abbreviated, but every step is there.
I have some questions from the people who are watching this. So first question is by Sakshi Sinha. She's saying, what special qualities do you always want in your reference image? Do you want to give any suggestions to artists about choosing a reference image?
Okay, that's a really good question. My big thing, number one, is value. I need to see in my image something that has a value 1 all the way to a 9. In other words, all the way from, you know, lightest light, the white of the paper, to 9, like lamp black. And I need to see a variety of that in my image. So a lot of light and shadow, a lot of value jumps. And now I like to see them in different amounts. Like if it's a day scene, obviously my 9 is going to be this much and my 1 is going to be much bigger because of the light. But my night scenes, it's the opposite, where I can do a big dark wash over everything, mask off whatever's lighter, and do a big dark mushy wash, you know, to get that 8 or 9. So value is probably the number one thing. And subject, that subject I don't even think about. If it hits me that I like the subject, I already know I'm going to paint it when I'm taking the photo. So it's not like I have to go through photos going, oh, I don't know what to paint today. I have thousands of photos that I still want to paint. And I wouldn't have taken the picture if I didn't want to paint them. So it's just a matter of when I paint them. But now when I start picking down through the photos, I'm looking for that value. I'm looking for an interesting composition where the shadows, like I love cityscapes or brick buildings with fire escapes. I love all the diagonal cuts of the shadows of those steps. And, you know, so it's just, that's personal. I mean, your thing might be color. And in which case, make sure that you have an unequal, never do a 50-50, but unequal amount of warm to cool. If yeah. you're more into,
I prefer 70-20.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you never want 50-50 of anything. Like, I would never want a painting that's 50%, you know, dark and then 50% light. That would be odd, you know. So, you always want to make sure you're off. At least 60-40 is, that's pushing it. 70-30 is best, right in there, of difference in values or difference in temperature or color.
Yeah, I have actually gone through several books from Renaissance period artists, and they mostly preferred 70-30. And
60-40 pushed it, but if you can do it, sometimes those are very powerful paintings because it is just on that edge, and it almost makes the viewer feel edgy looking at it. So if you have the right subject, that is a great thing if you can pull it off. But 70-30 is what most of us look for.
Right.
As our own paintings.
So Sakshi, I would like to add here, because you know every artist have got their own way of selecting a reference image. So Laurie said that she likes more of paintings which have a high contrast. I also like a high contrast painting. I would suggest all the artists here that, you know, first thing is that your concepts of principles of art has to be thorough. It is not like you, if you don't know, like, you know, 2 days back, I was talking to one very good artist from India, and he was showing me some painting. And I said that if you want to have a drastic improvement in your painting, go and implement principles of art at least 4 to 6. So he said, what is principles of art? And I know this person from pretty long time. So the thing is, many artists, they don't know what exactly is principles of art. If you don't know, not a problem. Go and Google it out. There are tons of information on Google, and find out principles of art. At least 4, if you implement, then your painting will be brilliant. Because, you know, nowadays, mostly people hardly know principle of art. They don't go too deep into studying what exactly makes a good painting. So they just make a painting. So implement at least 4, not 1 or 2. If you make it 4, people will stop scrolling and look at your painting. That is for sure. I have got another question from Masuma. She's also from India. She said, hello, Meeta and Laurie. I have a question. How do you gauge the value of your art? How do you define its worth? And what defines a good artist? Are there any parameters that you follow? That is her question.
Okay. I think we touched on already gauging the value of your art. And Meeta said it best. If you love the painting, if you love the work of art, you made a good work of art. Okay. Because it has to come from the artist first. If you're not crazy about it, chances are nobody out there is going to be crazy about it either. But monetarily, if you're talking that way, it goes back to what John Selman was saying, and that's, you don't value your art on like a per hour basis or a you know, I just want to get this commission, so I'm going to do it really cheap, you know. So, you know, you have to value your art. If you don't, nobody else will. If I was throwing paintings out at $200 a piece, I could sell everything I have in my house if I did that. But I'm also telling the world that's what I think it's worth. So if that's what I think it's worth, then, and oddly enough, people are going to think if that's what she thinks it's worth, it's got to be worth even less, because that's the mentality of buyers in the world market when it comes to anything. If that's the price, maybe I could talk them down because it's probably worth less. So my highest selling painting to date was $7,500. Okay, I'm not at the level yet of like Angus or Dean Mitchell or any of them yet, but I'm working that way. But that doesn't mean every one of my paintings is worth that either. So I gauge it by how much of my skill went into that painting, how much I like it. And then honestly, is it something I want to keep in my own collection? There are some paintings I won't sell that are very important to me, either because of a personal reason to the subject, or my homeless guy, which almost everybody knows that painting of my homeless man in front of the trash can. That painting I'll never sell because it has been published so many times. It's just always been one of my favorites, you know, so that's one I'll never sell. But most of mine are for sale, but at a reasonable price. I've turned down offers that most artists would have said, oh yeah, I'll sell it for that amount. I'd sell anything for that amount. And it's like, no, that painting is worth more than that. And even if down the road after you're gone and your posterity, your children or grandchildren are selling your work, you better have that value on it, because down the road, it's not going to get more valuable just because you're gone. If you, in your lifetime, you thought your paintings were worth 200, now you're dead, maybe your paintings will be worth 400, but it's still not maybe what they're worth. You've got to see the worth in your own work or nobody will. And how I gauge or what I think of as someone being a good artist goes back to something else I said. Number one, passion. If you have passion for anything, you will be great at it. Just give it time, give it practice. The passion will make you practice. The practice will make you better.
I am noting down if I qualify in that, what you're saying.
And getting better will bring success. And oh, here's something else I wanted. This is really important because this is something during those 4 or 5 years that kind of terrified me when I was starting out, is I kept reading the biographies of these artists that were judging shows, because they come right in the prospectus, like, you know, John Selmanen went to school here, blah, blah, blah. And I'm sitting there thinking, oh, I would love to go teach workshops someday. I would love to jury shows and be able to put my own shows together, what I like. And I'm like, it'll never happen because I didn't go to college and I didn't go to art college or architectural college, you know, like Tom Schaller or whatever. It's like, and I'm sitting there thinking that you have to do that or you're just never gonna succeed.
You have to dream.
If you can dream it, you can do it. And it's a fact. I put in just the work of practice and self-educating myself. I did get lucky because it takes, and the only luck is the right juror seeing your work at the right time. That's the only lucky part. People are not just blessed with luck all over the place. So the right juror judged that magazine competition that I got third place, which started the ball rolling for me. And then, and how I started teaching workshops was my local art guild or watercolor society in West Virginia asked me to teach first. And from there, I'll tell everybody this secret too. Every January, I send out a packet to every watercolor society, state art guild that does watercolors, any kind of watercolor group. I send a little email packet to them every January saying, I'm teaching, here's a list of my workshops, you can get on my website and take a look. I'd love to come paint with y'all, blah, 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 happy holidays. And now it goes in.
Send me that packet. I would like But after this interview, please.
Yeah, okay, well, but it's just an easy way to keep, because I mean, there's so many artists out there teaching. You got to keep your name in front of these people. You got to have them, oh, she's still teaching. Because a lot of times if they're not watching you on Facebook or they're not, you know, not friends of yours on Facebook, they might think, oh, I haven't heard from her in years. She's probably not teaching anymore. And they're not going to call you, you know, so I just keep my name out there. And that's how I started teaching outside the state. And here's another, not a failure story, but a kind of get tough, scary story is, and everybody knows this because I told them at my local watercolor society, but that very first workshop, we were all staying upstairs in the hotel and the workshop space was in the basement in this big conference room. So it was the first day I'm going down the stairs and I literally stopped in the middle of the staircase. I was by myself and I had like this panic attack, like full blown. These people have all been painting way longer than me. And they were, you know, and I'm going, what am I going to teach these people? What are you doing, Laurie? You're not ready for this. You know, all of a sudden it hit me how I was, these people paid money for this. They're expecting things. I had a panic attack. But basically what I told myself was, Laurie, these people paid for this. And I had 22 people in that first workshop. We were crammed full. And I'm sitting there going,
your first workshop? First workshop, 22?
Yeah. And I was sitting there like,
four students.
Oh, I've had some like that too. But I was like, I was like shaking. And all of a sudden something came over me and I was like, Laurie, these people paid for this. They're waiting for you. Get your butt into that room. Get moving. And that started me walking again. But I was like terrified. And it went great. We all had a great time. I've taught for them, I think, twice since, and we always have a great time. But I told them all that story, how scared I was. And they were like, oh, I don't know why, we had a great time.
But and it was, you know, it's amazing. This is for everyone who is listening here. Every person has to go through the path of fear in order to get confidence. This is not inborn. What you are seeing at me and Laurie, this is after we have passed through the phase of fear. Many artists, they don't show that on Facebook. It doesn't mean that they don't come across those situations. When I was going for my very first book signing event in 2017, I was telling myself, my name is Meeta Dani. I'm from India. I live in Vancouver. Like this, I was continuously repeating it because I was having a fear that when I will stand up on the stage, I will forget that my name is Meeta Dani. You know, how I was thinking, that was the fear, you know, but then also I went to that and I was so shivering, like, you know, there was more than 20, 30 people there in that small room and the interview was there and I was like, my name is Meeta Dani. I am from like that. Yeah, I cannot laugh enough on that, but actually that was the case. And everyone has to pass through that. There is no
over-rehearsed. You over-rehearsed. That's one thing I've learned is that Meeta sent me some questions ahead of time, things we would touch on. I glanced at it and I put it away because that's something I've learned. I have over-rehearsed when I started doing workshops or evening demos. And I sounded like a robot. I'm like, my name is Laurie Goldsetin-Warren. I live in West Virginia. I was like a little kid doing a recitation in school.
So but like, this is exactly what happens.
Yeah. Oh, and here's another funny. It's always, the funny stuff always happens in Texas. But this is another group in Texas. And it was an evening demo. And it was a full house. There was a bunch of people there. I don't even know how many. It was in one of those big like theater kind of college rooms with all the seats that go up. So I'm sitting there and we're all ready to start. And they did the intro and then I introduced myself. I go to start painting and people are like, wait a minute. On the screen, my hands weren't showing. So the camera wasn't working above. And they go, oh, the camera's not working. So then there was one of the professors who teaches in that room normally, he was there. So he comes up and he starts fiddling with it and he can't get it. So he goes, well, I'm gonna have to call tech and get them over here. He goes, it should just be about 15 or 20 minutes. I look up and there's 120 plus eyeballs looking at me. I'm sitting in front of this group and nothing's going to happen for 15 to 20 minutes. So I had to think about what to say. And this is where not being over rehearsed helped because I wouldn't have had a clue. So I just looked at everybody. And I said, okay, what do y'all want to talk about? And that was it. We just started question and answering each other and just, we had a great time for those 15 to 20 minutes. And then he came, fixed the camera and we got going. But at first there was that little panic because there's everybody staring at you. And they're like, okay, entertain us now for 15 or 20 minutes without painting. Just entertain us. I'm like, oh boy. So we entertained each other. It was good.
Here, my trick always works. So whenever I have this type of situation, nowadays what I do, I tell them that you cannot become a very good artist if you don't know how to plan. So let's do the planning. So I take a whiteboard and I start doing the planning. And by that time I finish the planning, the problem gets sorted out. So, you know, of being nervous. Planning, I don't have to paint, right? We need to,
right.
When we're doing the planning, we don't have to paint. Planning is all That's about right. understanding the sequence and why we should do this, why we should do that. The students right. get a lot of knowledge. They don't feel that it is a waste of time. I also feel mm-hmm. that I'm giving a lot of information. I don't feel guilty about it. And, mm-hmm. you know, this is the best utilization of the time which I have if something goes wrong, horribly wrong.
Yeah, and the good thing is, too, is with me, and it probably has more to do with my upbringing in an Irish-German household and five brothers and sisters, but is that I always found that as soon as I could get that first joke, and it's nothing I've rehearsed, it's something that presents itself, like my very first evening demo was for the Baltimore Watercolor Society, and that was a packed room, and it was really hot. They had these lights, like, right on me. So, of course, I'm just, like, perspiring. And I know the people in the front row could see the sweat just coming down the side because I'm nervous. It's hot, crowded room. So, finally, I just was like, I'm not even going to pretend this isn't happening. And I'm painting, and I go, I know you people in the front can see this. I'm dabbing. And I go, I know the people in the front can see this. I said, if hot flashes were an Olympic event, I'd be a gold medalist, you know, because I was going through hot flashes at the time. So I'm like, dab. Everybody in the room cracked up laughing, even the men, because they were all of an age where they were with women that were going through it. So everybody's laughing. Once I get that first joke out of the way, I am pretty relaxed. It usually just takes making everybody laugh, which to me says, at least for that moment, they're all happy to be there. They're laughing, they're having a good time. Then I can relax and get into my painting. So I always try to get a joke out of the way somewhere in the beginning, whatever presents itself. It's usually some joke about me, not about somebody else, but.
Okay, so can I ask you one last question here? Like, you know, this is not from my side, this is from all the other people who are upcoming artists from their side, because many of the people, artists, they think that what makes a good artist, and you said that. So what mm-hmm. are the things which you think that it is important for success? So one thing you said that passion is very important, right? So
right.
What are the things which are super crucial for success? I think you have given a little bit of light, but I want you to elaborate on that.
Okay. Definitely, passion is important. Self-discipline as far as working on your craft, even if it's doing research, even you don't have to always be painting. You could be actually reading, not just looking at pictures, which we all do, but actually reading articles, reading art books. So educating yourself, being disciplined, and a big thing, which we all learned, I forget what year this was at the AWS, but integrity, following the rules. And I'm not talking about rules in painting. I'm talking about rules of competition, bringing other artists up, not always being critical. I mean, even when I'm critiquing in workshops, there's always something I like about somebody's work. So I always say that first. Then I say, the only thing I see that it could use tweaking or changing is this. So, you know, or this and this, whatever. But there's always a compliment first. And it's easy. I love art. So there's always going to be something I like. So having integrity, bringing up other people, not saying I have to be on top and nobody can be up here with me, which I'm not on top. I'm talking about if I was. That's a bad attitude. We should all be nurturing each other and bringing each other up. It's why I'm so happy to be part of GAWA, because it is like that. I mean, I feel a great community with the 9 leaders. I feel
you are one community. Of the leaders.
What I mean. I think it's a great community you brought together, and I love the ideas that we're going to be working towards. But that's all important. And, you know, just never forget that you're part of a community. That even though we're in a solitary practice a lot of times when we're painting, if you start to feel lonely or you start to feel discouraged, Facebook is good about this. I'm sure you all have friends who you're closer with, who you bounce work off of and show things in progress. Do that with your friend. You know, don't get too solitary and into your own head where you're not enjoying it anymore. So I do that. I mean, I have a couple friends that one I've been painting with for as long as I've been painting. she was the one I was visiting when I broke my shoulder. And, I'll bounce work off of her sometimes. Like if I'm sitting here and I'm painting, I'm kind of like, I'm not lonely, but just kind of, I just want to hear somebody else's input on this right now. So I'll send it to her because she sees all my stuff at all stages, you know, and just do things like that. Keep it interesting, mix it up. Big thing, which somebody just wrote a whole thing on, which I agree with. If you have a successful painting like me with my homeless guy, it was my first successful painting. Don't think that that's all you have to paint. I paint still life. I paint cityscapes. I paint landscapes. Just because it's a person, it's not like, oh, then I'm a portrait painter and that's all I paint. Keep it interesting, mix it up. You don't have to paint just one subject or one style necessarily all the time. My poured paintings don't look, some of them look kind of similar to my brush paintings, but they're not exactly the same. So you can mix it up with techniques or whatever, but have fun. Just always keep it fun. Keep your integrity as an artist, as a human being. And bolster other artists who are coming up behind you all the time, because you're growing together. We're all growing. You're still growing. Yeah, Angus, I think, said that in his interview. I don't care how good you are. If you stop learning, you're stagnant. Everybody needs to keep learning and growing. So once you stop, you're kind of done. You know, people will look at it and go, yeah, same thing. Yeah, I've seen him or her do that. Yeah. You know, but if you're always learning new things, you can pop a little surprise in there once in a while in your new work. So just have fun and enjoy it and work hard. Keep the passion alive, you know, and I'm always here if anybody wants to bounce a painting off of me. I love looking at people's work. So you can always send it to me through Facebook. I'll take a peek.
Yeah, so it is more than 1 hour, 10 minutes now. I'm so grateful to Laurie that you devoted this much time, this huge amount of time with us, so that upcoming artists can get benefited, people can get a lot of knowledge. See, all this knowledge which she said today, you will not find it in any books. You will not even find this type of knowledge directly. So she is one of the 9 leaders with which I am working towards improving the world watercolor market. I want that all of you, please help me and Laurie to spread all these words of knowledge which she shared. Share this post on your Facebook page and also tag your friend. Maybe they will get benefited by what Laurie said. She said a lot of good things today. Even I have written so many points in my notepad, and I'm going to implement. See, one thing I would like to say here, many times when we hear something, we listen to them, but we fail to implement it. Even if you do small implementation every single day, then you will change your whole life. If you simply listen to what I'm saying, what Laurie is saying, and don't implement, you know, you are actually wasting your time in simply listening also. Simply listening or simply reading or simply going through an article is not going to be fruitful unless and until you implement. Okay. So I have got 2 requests. Number one, next time I come up with an interview, please ask your questions beforehand when I declare the interview so that I can accommodate your questions. Second, I think I have 3 requests. So the second is, please implement what she's saying. And number third is, please share this post. If you don't share, you know, we will not be able to reach more artists. And my only aim is to bring up the world watercolor market. She is also having the same aim to bring up the world watercolor market. And that will not happen unless each and every of watercolor artists, they change from inside and not just from outside. Okay. So this mindset change, resilience, and all these things will change only if we keep on hearing to all such artists, great artists like Laurie. So, I hope you value this type of interview and you put up your questions beforehand so that I can accommodate those questions. Thank you so much, Laurie. I can't thank you enough, actually. You have added so much value. I have written so many things which I actually need to implement. I will do that without fail. I'm too strict with myself sometimes. And if you said that paint every day, I will make sure that I paint every day.
Yeah, you should. Your paintings are wonderful. We need to see more.
I will paint every day, every single day. Actually, I used to paint every day, but after this Gava thing came up, I lost track. I must admit that, you know, I lost track.
You are a busy person, that is for sure. You're very busy.
No. I'm just this much. Okay. Yeah. So thank you so much, Laurie. I will send this interview to you, and you can also share on your Facebook and on YouTube video or anywhere, whichever you like. And I will ask you for that small packet which you sent.
Okay. Will do. Will do.
Thank you so much for your precious time. And I learned a lot. And I'm very sure that whoever is watching this video have learned a lot. Okay, thank you. And thank you, viewers, for watching this video. You know, without you, our video, our interview cannot become a success. Without audience, there is actually no value to the videos. If nobody watches, nobody encourages us, then even I will feel discouraged. So thank you so much for joining me live, and Laurie. And I hope you like this interview, and I will keep up coming with very, very good renowned artist in the future. And I hope you will get inspired and motivated. Thank you so much. I will end this video. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.